Hi, I'm Vincent from the Kusto team, and today we're going to talk about the Kusto emulator and we're going to install it. So this is an installation walkthrough. What is a Kusto emulator? So it's a containerized version of Kusto. So we took the actual Kusto code for the query engine and we put it inside a Docker container. So now you can run that on your laptop or you can run that on CI/CD agent. So you can use that to automate your tests or to do local development. Now you know what a Kusto emulator is. Let's see how to install it. I'm going to install the container in a virtual machine in Azure. I'm going to use Windows 11. And I want something with enough RAM that I can run the container. So I'd suggest 16 gigabytes of RAM and above. We do have an installation guide in the official Azure Data Explorer documentation. If I look for emulator, I have an overview that explains what the emulator is, what are the limits, and I get the install guide, basically. So first, let's look at the prerequisites. It requires one of the following OS, at least 2 GB of RAM. I have 4, and a Docker client. So I think this VM doesn't have Docker install. Doesn't know what Docker is. So let's install this. And after installing, I'll need to reboot the laptop, or in this case, the VM. Okay, I installed the Docker client. I rebooted my machine. Now Docker is installed. So let's proceed to the installation of the Kusto emulator. So first I need to switch to Windows container. So basically go in the tray, find the Docker icon, right click on it, and switch to Windows container. I have this error popping up. I need to run this in PowerShell. So I'm gonna use the integrated script environment, IZE, and run the command. Want to restart? Yes. And we're back. I restarted the VM. Now if I go here, I can switch to Windows container and we're good. The next thing is to actually run the container. I'm going to do it in PowerShell. You can do it in any cell you want. And just before I run it, let me explain a bit the command. So we pass an environment variable, accept EULA. That's the way to accept the terms and conditions of the container image. It's the equivalent when you install something and it asks you read the kind of term conditions. So when you pass that, because container is not an interactive UI, we need to do that with an environment variable. So please read it. Then we ask for 4 GB of RAM. Then we map the container port 8080 to the VM or your laptop port 8080. And then we go to Microsoft Container Registry and get the container latest version. So the error we see here isn't really an error, it's that Docker doesn't find the image locally, so it goes and pulls the image. And because it's a Windows container, it's pretty big, it's over 10 gigabytes, it's gonna take a little while. All right, so the pull and the run is completed. So if we run something like Docker PS, we're gonna see that we have an image running, so there's a container instance running our Kusto emulator image. Now we can run a simple test to see if it runs properly. In the documentation, we suggest a curl. So basically we do a post. We're using the Kusto API, but locally. So we post a command show cluster on the local host 8080, the port that we mapped. And we receive an okay. Basically it seems to work fine. Now a real test would be to run real queries. Let's try that. Let's install locally the Kusto Explorer because we need some client to interface with the container. Now I have my Kusto Explorer client running locally. Let's add a connection to to connect to our container. So if you read the documentation, we explain at length what are the limitations of Kusto Emulator. One of the things is that we don't support any security scheme. So we don't support HTTPS and we don't support authentication. So how do we do that? We're gonna do localhost 8080. You noticed I removed the S, so it's HTTP localhost. Of course, it's not meant to run in production or any sort of secured environment, just meant to run locally. And then I'm gonna come here, gonna look at the connection string. It's fine, but I don't want any AAD authentication because we don't support authentication. I'm gonna remove this and I'm good to go, clicking OK. Now I have a new connection. I can come here, I can do type queries such as show cluster and the container response. And I can do other things such as, I don't know, show capacity, tells me what it is. I'm interested only in, so I can run queries. At this point I could create a database, but what I want to show you is how to run the container in a way that I have a persistent database. Because as we know, Docker containers are ephemeral, so once I stop it, everything inside it is gone. So I want instead to mount a local drive to my container so I can persist the database to that local drive and use it later. I'm gonna come here, I'm gonna stop my container. So I'm gonna do Docker kill and the name of the container ID. Now if I run Docker PS, no containers are running. If I come back to my earliest command to run the container, I'm gonna use that. But I'm gonna mount a local folder to the container. So I do that, I could go back to the documentation. If you look at run emulator options underneath, you see that there's this bits in the command that I need to run. Let's do that. So what does that do? It mounts a volume and it takes the host local folder of my computer and maps it to the /crystal data inside the container. So I first need to create that. Host data. So now the folder exists and now I can run my container. And you can tell it didn't like it one bit because I put the run command after, shouldn't do that. Now complains that the host data doesn't exist. That is true because I call this thing data instead of local. So data is a good name and keep it. Boom. Now it should be running. I'm going to create a database. So if you just want to run tests, you don't need to persist your database like that. I just wanted to show you how to do that. And you can just create a volatile database. But in our case, we want to create a persistent database. So I'm going to do that. So I go back to Kusto Explorer and I run a command that we usually don't run when we use Kusto in the cloud. And I'm going to create a database. I have to name my database, create it persistent, call it my MD. So you see that there are two folders important, the MD and the data. When I run that command, Kusto is going to create a database and hopefully put it in this folder. So you see there's a subfolder database, DBs. Inside I get my DB, then I got two folders. And you can look at it if you want. Basically it saves the extents and the metadata. Okay, now I've created my database. Let's ingest some data. Going back to the article, some very, very simple data set, basically a CSV. Let's call it sample.csv. And I'm gonna populate it like this. And then I'm gonna run the command. I'm gonna create a table to accommodate for the data. And then I'm gonna ingest the data. So instead of pointing to a storage account here, I'm pointing to a local folder, local to the container's point of view. So it's c/crystal data/sample.csv. And that should work. And you can see that something is odd, like I got an extent ID 000. So that's weird. I have an error in ingestion, so show ingestion failures. And I see I did have one on my ingested sample. So what is it? Download source not found. That's weird because I put it there. So I just wanted to show you because I've done that error before. The problem is that it's actually a text file. If I rename it, now it's a real legit CSV file. If I run it, you can see now there's an extent. If I take that table and query it, didn't select a database to query, sorry. Okay, just realized that I ran those commands in the net default database. So let me do that again. All right, and there I have table. And of course, I can summarize if I want to. So for instance, I could add the max ID. So there you go. So we've seen how to install the container, how to run it, how to run persistent versus volatile databases. And we're good to go to do local development or automated testing. So try it out. It's a free offering. We're quite excited about it. And we're looking forward to hear about your comments and your feedback.